the jailers and the guards had heart attacks, had strokes, because they were so shaken by the fact that Stalin died. Under Stalin, no one of any influence was supposed to die without Stalin's permission. The whole idea with Stalin was that he had been incorporated into all of them. All their lives revolved around what Stalin was thinking, what Stalin was doing, day in, day out. Then all of a sudden, he's not there anymore. Stalin was at his dacha, his country home, outside of Moscow. He spent a lot of time there. And the rule was that when Stalin was in his private quarters, his guards or the maids could not go in unless he summoned them, unless he invited them, particularly in the morning when he'd wake up. Stalin was nocturnal, which means he'd stay up half the night working, and he'd sleep till 11 in the morning or 12 noon, and then he would ring a bell and ask for tea, ask for coffee, ask for breakfast, get the papers. So the guards would not enter his rooms until they were summoned. That was part of the security arrangement. So when Stalin collapsed from a stroke, he was paralyzed. He couldn't shout for help. He couldn't ring a bell. No one knew what was happening. And the guards were afraid to enter without being summoned. I think he admired Hitler. I think he admired Hitler for his ruthlessness. There are examples we have where he admitted that, you know, when Hitler purged the Stresner and the brown shirts, Stalin said, oh, that's something I could admire. You know, I could see doing that myself. Stalin only trusted one person, and that was Hitler. And Hitler betrayed him.
So what I want to say is,
I think capitalism is the best we've came up with so far. Up until now, it's the best we can do. Okay, so my definition of communism is a utopia and a structure of ideas. Communism by itself is good, but the problem is that it's unimplementable. Communism is based on the goal of eliminating socioeconomic stress and class struggles by creating a classless society in which everyone shares the benefits of labor and the state controls all the property and wealth. So, equity. When you start implementing communism, you kill it by default. There is no such thing as a policy that can effectively implement communism into a society. I'm sure we agree happiness is good. Now try to implement it into a society. I think this is like using sledgehammer to plant a tree. As soon as you want to implement communism, you destroy it and the implementation doesn't work. I think we can have the correct values, but if we implement them incorrectly, it's as if we don't have them in the first place. Communism is only an ideology and a utopia, and by itself is good, but it's unimplementable.
Is something interfering with your happiness or preventing you from achieving your goals? Starting therapy can be hard. The right therapist for you may not be in your area. BetterHelp is now sponsoring this podcast. BetterHelp connects you with a licensed therapist who is trained to listen and give you helpful, unbiased advice. With BetterHelp, you can have your therapy session as a phone call, as a video chat, or even via messaging if you prefer that. If you think you might benefit from therapy, consider BetterHelp. Click the link in the description or visit betterhelp.com/captainise. Clicking that link helps you support this channel, and it also gives you a 10% off your first month of BetterHelp so you can connect with a therapist and see if it helps you. Again, go to betterhelp.com/captainise. Clicking that link gives you 10% off your first month of therapy.
Well, let me say first that I'm always skeptical of any messianic dream. Any messianic dream. So you want to dress up communism as a wonderful idea in itself, but it's unimplementable. Well, we've seen it attempted in many different societies in the former Soviet Union, in different countries in Eastern Europe when it was implanted by the Red Army. We've seen it in North Korea. We've seen it in Cuba. And, you know, the human toll is just endless, bottomless. Tens of millions of victims in every one of these societies. Now, that doesn't absolve capitalism for its inequities, but there's capitalism with democracy and there's capitalism without democracy. And if you have basic civil freedoms, civil liberties being respected within a capitalist system, then you have the means for different people to vie for power, to vie for their ideas, to campaign for their ideas without the threat of arrest, without the threat of execution, simply for their ideas. So if you have capitalism with a very strong commitment to democratic ideals, then perhaps you can limit the inequitable aspects of capitalism. Of course, capitalism isn't perfect. No system is perfect. No human system could be perfect. But if you have basic respect for human rights, for democratic values, within a market economy, all in all, these societies fare much better. Look at Scandinavia. Look at Western Europe. Now, these are different kinds of capitalism. Capitalism comes in different forms. But in the best of these places, there's a commitment to democratic values. That's what matters. And communism dispenses with democratic values. And that is its tragic flaw. And it was always its tragic flaw.
So, Stalin, I kind of do sympathize with the difficulty of implementing prosperity, but do you think he, behind closed doors, did actually believe he was doing good by implementing communism? I believe he was. I could be wrong. What's your take?
Well, I think it's a mixed record. It's very hard to know what he believed actually. He certainly believed in having absolute power. He certainly believed in a certain kind of Marxist ideology. But, you know, he was completely indifferent to the suffering he inflicted on the Soviet people. And I think his thirst for power, for individual power, outweighed any kind of ideological loyalty he had to a very orthodox version of Marxism. After all, within Marxism, there are people who want to uphold democratic values. Perhaps they're more socialist than communist. But Stalin had no patience, and neither did Lenin, neither did Trotsky, after all, for democratic values, for what we regard as what we call civil liberties and human rights. They were more than happy to dispense with that in order to impose their messianic dream onto this enormous society. And it came with a tremendous human cost.
Do you think it was more about power, or was it more about the fact that in order to make an omelet, you need to break a few eggs? So for the better of the whole society, we will dispense with some people because that's just what you get as a side effect.
And that's why all these leaders, Lenin, Trotsky, Stalin, they all kind of wanted to justify their actions with these kinds of messianic dreams. So they dream of justice and then they wreak havoc. And that has to be exposed.
Enslavement for the sake of liberation. He said, yeah, one death is a tragedy. A million deaths is a statistics. How would you describe Stalin's social intelligence? How did the other leaders he met describe him?
I think, to be fair to Joseph Stalin, he's probably in some ways the most underrated of all the dictators. After all, he led the Soviet Union with absolute power for about 25 years. When he took over, it was mostly a peasant society. And when he died in March of 1953, it was the second most powerful country in the world. It has an enormous landmass. It was in control of Eastern Europe. It had reached some kind of rough parity with the United States because it had been able to construct an atomic bomb and was on the verge of designing a hydrogen bomb. So it was a very powerful military, but the society and the economy were backward by Western standards. And so in some ways, Stalin could be said to have been a very successful dictator in his terms. but how he left the Soviet Union, what kind of country it was in the spring of 1953, how many victims he had created. And the fact is, he's left a legacy that the Soviet Union and now Russia has yet to overcome. I mean, I'm often asked to compare Stalin as a dictator and the legacy of Stalin to the legacy of Franco or Salazar or other dictators of the 20th century. And after all, after Franco died in 1975, Spain was ready to be a functioning democracy and join other Western European countries and is a very prosperous society today with all of its problems. Every country has its unique problems. Portugal, after Salazar, also became a functioning democracy. Whereas in the Soviet Union, after Stalin died, the dictatorship survived without that particular dictator. But still, it was a dictatorship of the Communist Party that tried to limit the kind of terror methods that Stalin had implemented. They disavowed some of the worst aspects of Stalinism. I mean, some people say they moved from a cannibal stage to a vegetarian stage, a kind of cynical definition of Stalinism to what Khrushchev and the thaw were able to accomplish. But the 1950s and 1960s under Khrushchev, comparatively speaking, that was a very exciting time in Soviet history because of greater contact with the West, greater cultural freedom, greater freedom of cultural expression, but politically still very much controlled by a one-party state. We should not forget that.
I think you can see the effect of that at how people in, like, for example, in Nazi Germany, people in the concentration camps reacted to being rescued and reacted to the end of Hitler, and then compare it to how people in gulags reacted to Stalin's death, because they weren't... Actually, what was the reaction of these people when they found out that Stalin died?
Many of them were still in shock. We have the testimony of Lydia Ginsberg in her books Out of the Whirlwind and Into the Whirlwind, where she says even the jailers and the guards had heart attacks, had strokes, because they were so shaken by the fact that Stalin died. And the prisoners were also shaken. She quotes this one prisoner, which I quote in my book, where she said, under Stalin, no one of any influence was supposed to die without Stalin's permission. As if Stalin couldn't, he had to give himself permission to die. So it was still a very disorienting situation for them. Although they were thrilled that he had died because they saw that was the possibility that they would survive and maybe be released before their terms would end, which is what happened. But still, it was a very disorienting situation because the whole idea with Stalin was that he had been incorporated into all of them. All their lives revolved around what Stalin was thinking, what Stalin was doing, day in, day out. Then all of a sudden, he's not there anymore.
When Tito died, and where I live, there were a lot of children, like small kids, 2, 3 years old, who were crying because the leader died. And they never met him. They didn't know anything about him. Stalin's son, Yakov, he was actually a soldier fighting on the front line. He was captured by the Germans. And after they captured him, they asked Stalin if he wants to exchange the German generals that the Soviets captured for his son. And Stalin notoriously said, "I don't exchange soldiers for generals." Would you describe Stalin as someone who was traumatized?
It's very hard to do this kind of armchair psychology of a political leader, let alone someone as such an extreme example of a bloodthirsty dictator like Stalin. There are reports that when his first wife died, that he was very shaken, that he loved her as a young man, she was the mother of his first child, and that this was a very traumatic event from emotionally. But, you know, even if that were true, and it could well be true, that doesn't turn someone into a mass killer. That doesn't turn someone into a sadistic killer the way Stalin was. After all, these kinds of human tragedies occur in every society. People die, people get sick, but we've all just experienced this COVID epidemic. Many families were devastated by tragedy because of COVID. But that doesn't mean that all the survivors now become homicidal maniacs. So there is something about Stalin and his nature, maybe from his upbringing, that made him susceptible to what power gave him, which was the opportunity to rule other men and women, to rule that society, and to kill with impunity.
What's your take on neo-Marxism and postmodernism? I guess what I'm asking is, how big is the threat of the history repeating itself?
Well, history always is the threat of repeating itself. It's never exactly the same, but so my basic commitment, which I still sustain, is to basic ideas of human liberty. Just simple democratic values. You don't arrest people for their ideas. You treat people humanely. If they're your prisoner, you treat them humanely. And you don't suspend these values in times of emergency. You look to those values to guide you through an emergency. And I suppose all of our societies still face that threat. Here we are in the United States. So here we are in a mature democracy, and tens of millions of people look like they would succumb to that temptation. It's just the appeal of a demagogue like Trump and very gullible people, unfortunately. And we'll see what happens. But even America has this weakness. And if Trump is elected, it will have repercussions around the world, not just in the United States. It's a very worrisome thing.
The definition of authoritarian state involves the use of strong central power to preserve the political status quo, which implies that it's top down. In practicality, I think it's actually bottom up. I think it's established when every member of the society lies and it's ready to betray a fellow member, which is what we see in North Korea now. And we saw that in Soviet Union. There were gulags, which were by definition, I guess, peasants that were better off. And Stalin introduced quotas for these gulags for each village. So those gulags would be subject to execution, right? So let's say we have a village of 300 people and the quota is 50. So, well, we have to find 50 gulags now that in that village. So the question is, who is a gulag exactly? And how many farm animals can you need? And if you have barely enough, but everyone has less than you, then you're the gulag. So obviously you don't want to be labeled as gulag because you got a family. And just because you have one horse more than your neighbor and there's not 50 people who have more than you. I mean, social warfare was the reason why he was successful, because people would be pointing fingers at each other. So it would also be like a bottom-up approach. And I think we also saw that during COVID, because people were calling the police on people partying in like the next door. And maybe it was maybe moral superiority, but I think individuals have a lot to do with the state that they're in. Would you agree with that?
Only up to a point. When the state is using such a high degree of coercion, of fear, of cruelty, it's very hard to hold individuals responsible. It's another thing when you're in a democracy, when more or less there's no price to be paid for speaking out. It shouldn't be courageous to speak out in a democracy. There shouldn't be any kind of pressure when you for just speaking your mind. That's the whole point of freedom of expression, freedom of speech. That should require courage for individual citizens to speak their minds in the public square. But in a dictatorship where there's severe repercussions and severe penalty, it's very hard to hold people responsible for just lying low, keeping quiet, trying to survive. You can't judge people for not speaking out. You can celebrate people who are dissidents who take the risk, but you can't judge their fellow citizens who choose to be quiet, because the risk is too great.
Well, especially if you have a family. Why do you think was he so successful in implementing policies among people who were close to him, before he came to the point of so much suspiciousness towards people around him that he wouldn't let anyone near him. Why, these people who were in his close circle, why didn't anyone ever ask him, hey, do you think these policies may destabilize society a little bit?
Well, first, there's every reason to think that from time to time these issues were debated. There's every reason to think that sometimes Stalin would ask for feedback on one thing or another. I don't think he ruled strictly by decree and they said, you know, everything he did, but they weren't going to challenge him in a serious way. But after all, people like Molotov and Malenkov and Khrushchev and Bulganin, they worked alongside Stalin, some of them, for decades. And one has to assume there are things that were discussed. Maybe there are things they couldn't challenge him on, but maybe there were examples and times when he needed their feedback. Certainly during the war, he learned to listen to his generals, which was very important because he did not have the military experience they had and he needed their expertise to defeat the Germans.
I mean, the history up until 1935 makes more sense than after. By 1935, I think it looked, well, necessarily say bright, but they seemed to eradicate capitalism, implement socialism. The gulags have been executed. The peasants are on the farms planting their grains, and a lot of people who criticized Stalin before were not criticizing him anymore. So the country was off its back by then, and then everything seemed to be all right. But from then on, it's like going from peace to chaos. And here comes the era of Great Terror and Great Purge. Why? If everything seems okay, why the Great Purge?
Why did Stalin need to eliminate not just his close rivals, people who he had already defeated, like Zinoviev and Kamenev, for example? They were already marginalized figures within the party by the end of the 1920s. So why did he need to kill them in the 1930s and kill tens of thousands of other party members? I don't have a quick answer for that. I don't think anyone has an answer completely that can explain this kind of bloodletting on the eve of World War II. He not only killed, you know, loyal party members, he killed thousands of army officers. He decimated the officer corps of the Red Army in 1936 and 1937, when a war in Europe was obviously brewing. So this was tremendously destabilizing to the army. And when he needed the army, of course, once Hitler invaded. So
what was his relation with Hitler? How did he see Hitler?
I think he admired Hitler. I think he admired Hitler for his ruthlessness. There are examples we have where he admitted that, you know, when Hitler purged the Stresner and the brown shirts, Stalin said, "Oh, that's something I could admire. You know, I could see doing that myself." But then Solzhenitsyn commented once that Stalin only trusted one person, and that was Hitler, and Hitler betrayed him. And there's some truth to that because, after all, the pact with Hitler in August of 1939 led to the opening of World War II and the invasion of Poland, first by the Germans, then by the Red Army. And they divided Poland between them. And for 2 years, Stalin was a very loyal partner to Hitler. He gave him very substantial material support during those first 2 years of World War II. And then Hitler betrayed him by invading in June of 1941. So Stalin miscalculated, very tragic miscalculation, and millions paid the price for that miscalculation.
As far as citizens of Soviet Union, maybe those who were deported into gulags or for execution, did they as well believed in the ideas of communism? Did they see Stalin as someone who has good intentions for them. I'm asking because I'm gonna do an episode with a refugee from North Korea. And we talked before. She said that in North Korea, people know Kim Jong-un, but not the way we know him. People in the countryside, they actually believe that the leader loves them and is doing everything he can to protect him and to bring prosperity to their lives. So they're not aware of it. And I think Solzhenitsyn in Gulag Archipelago, he said that there were people on the train to gulags asking and crying out, "Oh, if Stalin only knew what's happening, he would do something about it."
Erska, that's the effect of propaganda, where you don't have a countervailing narrative, you don't have people contradicting what you're hearing, questioning it, and people want to believe that the whole situation is bewildering. We look at North Korea from the outside, and it's the most extreme example of a dictatorship. I mean, everywhere Kim Jong-un goes, people are writing down every word he says. And whenever you see him in public, everyone's applauding and jumping up and down and smiling and waving banners. And the whole thing is orchestrated. The whole thing is orchestrated. And it's very, it's hard for a Westerner even to grasp how absurd the situation is. And then you hear from refugees like the person you're speaking to, and according to them, people have no way to judge what they're facing. And yes, there were people in the Soviet Union in the 1930s, 1940s who told themselves, "Oh, Stalin isn't doing it. It's Beria's fault. It's somebody else's fault. It's security services. If only Stalin knew, he would rectify the situation. He would make it better." But that's just the effect of propaganda. Under Tito, Tito knew what was going on. He was responsible.
You've written a book, Last Days of Stalin, and from 1950s on, his health wasn't top-notch, so to speak. What was his reaction to him, well, to his health going bad? Because I know he was advised by a doctor or someone that he should retire. Obviously, he wasn't thrilled about that news, but and did he have a succession plan, by the way?
No, we know of no actual succession plan. It was generally believed that Georgi Malenkov was the number two. At the 19th Party Congress in October of 1952, months before Stalin collapsed, Stalin was not strong enough to deliver the report of the Central Committee to the Congress. He had delivered that report. And by the way, that was a speech he would read for 4 or 5 hours. Can you imagine? So he had always delivered that speech from the 1920s on. But in 1952, in October, he was no longer physically strong enough to stand at the lectern and lecture for 4 or 5 hours. So Malenkov gave the lecture. He read the speech. So it was that way of. Perhaps that was way, how Stalin signaled that Malenkov would be his successor should he depart the scene. But there was no plan in place. And after Stalin collapsed, Malenkov and Beria and Khrushchev and Bulganin began to discuss among themselves what's the way forward? How do we divide power? And they divided the power among themselves while Stalin was still alive but dying between Sunday, March 1st and Thursday, March 5th, when he died.
Yeah, I know he had like high blood pressure. I think he was putting iodine in hot water and drinking it, which is useless. But it wasn't until about 10 hours later that one of his cabinet members was able to make it to the remote cottage where he found Stalin twitching in a blood of his own urine. Why didn't anyone enter Stalin's room? Was that a rule? What
Yes, Stalin was at his dacha, his country home, in the town of Kuntsevo, about 10, 12 kilometers outside of Moscow. He spent a lot of time there. And the rule was that when Stalin was in his private quarters, his guards or the maids could not go in unless he summoned them. unless he invited them, particularly in the morning when he'd wake up. Stalin was nocturnal, which means he'd stay up half the night working or talking with Politburo members, and he'd sleep till 11 in the morning or 12 noon, and then he would ring a bell and ask for tea, ask for coffee, ask for breakfast, get the papers, and that's how his day began. So the guards would not enter his rooms until they were summoned. That was part of the security arrangement. So when Stalin collapsed from a stroke, he was paralyzed. He couldn't shout for help. He couldn't ring a bell. No one knew what was happening. And the guards were afraid to enter without being summoned. So according to Khrushchev, the guards had an elderly woman who had worked with Stalin for many years. She was like a maid at the dacha. She brought the official papers into him, because he would get papers every day from the Kremlin for him to read. She brought the papers in at 10 o'clock at night. And it was she who found Stalin lying in his own urine, half conscious, on the floor.
Was Stalin self-conscious about his looks, his height, his health?
Well, I don't think it's enough to say he was self-conscious. He knew he had certain problems with his health. He was treated for, he had difficulty walking. He had some balance issues beginning in the 1930s. He had a deformed left arm. He couldn't bend it properly, probably from some childhood injury that didn't heal properly. He had a pockmarked face from smallpox. So he had certain very evident physical deformities. We do believe that after World War II, he may have had some small strokes, maybe even a heart attack. No one can say for sure. But he did have high blood pressure, and we believe his personal doctor, Vinogradov, advised him to retire in 1952. And Stalin, of course, dismissed that idea out of hand. That was not possible. And Vinogradov was actually arrested in the fall of 1952, before the doctor's plot was officially announced in January of 1953, his personal physician was arrested and kept in chains. So the doctors who were the closest to Stalin were not available when he collapsed in March of 53. They were in jail. None of that would have mattered. The stroke was too severe. They could not have saved him. They could not have treated him properly. But that's what happened.
Do we have any comparisons between the gulags and the concentration camps as far as the so-called daily activities go?
Well, the gulag included outright concentration camps. It included settlements. It included people going into exile, were not otherwise detained. They were in remote cities, remote settlements, remote towns, typically in Siberia, in remote areas. That was all part of the gulag system. And then, of course, much of the gulag was forced labor in the mines, in the forests. Stalin saw this as a way to contribute to the economy. It was a very wasteful system. And after he died, his heirs released about 1 million people within a month of Stalin's death. They released about 1 million people, not because they were humanitarians, but because they saw it was just a waste of resources.
I'm stuck on the expression contributing to economy. In which way did he believe this is contributing the economy?
Well, it's forced labor. You don't have to pay people very well. They can cut the wood. They can ship the wood to the mines. They can build the mines. They can mine gold. They can mine other precious metals. You don't have to pay them much. You don't have to feed them much. You don't have to take care of their medical supplies. You don't have to give them good housing. It's forced labor. Well, that must work.
Is there which type of people would be taken to gulags? Is there any type of person who would kind of be exempt from this? I don't know, like a musician, a poet, someone who has literally nothing? Or would anyone and everyone be subject?
Well, everyone was vulnerable to arrest. But for example, Solzhenitsyn's famous novel, The First Circle, takes place in what was called a sharashka, which was a special type of prison, was a prison, where people with specific scientific ability would work on scientific projects in laboratories. And of course, they were treated better because, you know, they were doing serious scientific work. That was the point. They were not in mines. They were not outside in the forests. And so Solzhenitsyn created a novel around that idea. So that was one type of gulag. It was part of the gulag. Solzhenitsyn writes about people, you know, doing construction in Moscow, constructing buildings, renovating buildings after the war. So it could be in the major cities, or it could be in remote areas of Siberia or Mordovia, above the Arctic Circle. It was a very, very extensive system involving millions of prisoners. It wasn't just a prison here and a prison there.
Well, that seems to be one difference between a Nazi concentration camp. I think, well, at least here, the work had a certain purpose. I think in Nazi concentration camp, I read a book. It was about a prisoner who two Nazi guards would make him carry something from one point to another point and then back, and then do it 100 times for the sake of nothing, just for the sake of suffering. Suffering for the sake of suffering. At least in gulags, you were building something. You know what I mean? So,
after all, in the Nazi concentration camps, there was forced labor by the Krupp industrial magnate. They were building missiles. They were working in mines. So there was slave labor within the Nazi concentration camps, but the killing centers were devoted to killing people, not to exploiting their labor, like Treblinka and Auschwitz. They existed to kill people, and sometimes there was work, making clothes. There were some munitions factories, there was rocket building, there was mines, but that was a small part of the broader purpose, which was to kill the enemies of the Reich and the Jews and the Gypsies.
Stalin killed a lot of Jews as well. For some reason, it's not talked about.
The Jewish victims of Stalin, first in the 1930s, generally speaking, were not killed because they were Jews. They were killed because they were members of the party. They were vulnerable to arrest because they were active in the party, or leaders of industrial enterprises, or involved in certain intellectual enterprises that made them vulnerable. Not that they were Jews per se. After World War II, when there was the crackdown on the Jewish Anti-Fascist Committee, when there were crackdowns on Yiddish culture, then Jews were targeted because they were Jews. But we're not talking about tens of thousands of people. It wasn't the kind of industrial killing that we saw under Nazi Germany.
I think, well, Stalin took it to another level. I mean, Hitler was killing people, but Stalin killed altogether, we don't necessarily have a number, right? It's somewhere between 20 million and 50 million?
No. Memorial estimated 18 million, but after all, in World War II, we had 50 million deaths, and that should be laid at Hitler's doorstep.
What's your take on Putin? I'm not relating it to him, to Stalin in any way, but I just want to know your take on his policies and on his way of leading the country of Russia.
As it is about to be re-elected for the fourth or maybe the fifth time, he's essentially been in power since 1999, so that's just about 25 years. The country is increasingly repressive. Keep in mind, when he became the leader of Russia, Russian Federation, Yeltsin had democratic instincts. He was a very flawed man, a very flawed political figure, but he had democratic instincts. There was an independent TV station, for example. The press was wide open. There were independent newspapers and TV stations and radio stations. Putin gradually put a stop to all that. And he became more and more repressive. He concentrated more and more power in the Kremlin, in his own hands. Until today, he's a dictator. And it was Putin's decision to invade Ukraine, which is, you know, the invasion of Ukraine and the attacks on Ukraine make the invasion of Hungary, the invasion of Prague in 1968, look like child's play. It's far more devastating, far more destructive, far more violent than what the Red Army did in Budapest or Prague, or in East Germany in 1953, for that matter.
What do you tell your students who have, if there are some students who have communistic ideas and who believe that capitalism is evil and socialism is the yay-hay of all? What do you advise them? What
You know, I know there are people who reject capitalism and have this, you know, there's one thing to say, I reject capitalism, but I admire socialism in Sweden, which is a form of capitalism. But then if they say, no, I prefer Mao's China, or I have this idea that North Korea is some kind of utopia, I think they're stupid. They're uninformed and stupid. I don't know what else to call it.
How do you see the future of the United States?
Let's see what happens in November of 2024.
What do you see happen if the Biden stays the president?
I think, you know, our institutions will show their resilience. I think Biden is certainly a competent president. He's made mistakes, but every president makes mistakes. It's a very difficult job. But I think his heart is in the right place. I think the economy's done better. I think our democracy is more secure under Biden. So I would have more confidence in the future. But if Trump is elected, that I don't know what to make of it. I don't think anybody knows what to make of it. I don't think he knows what to make of it.
When you say last days of Stalin in your book, is that the last 4 days, the last 3 days, or the last 2 years?
The timeline of the book is basically from October of 1952 to June of 1953. So that I discuss the 19th Party Congress where Stalin made his last public speech in October of 1952, through the last months of his life, until his collapse on March 1st, his death on March 5th, and then I take the book to the arrest of Beria in June of 1953. And in the epilogue, I deal with the aftermath of Beria's arrest and his execution in December of 1953. But the bulk of the book is the fall of 1952 to June of 1953, a few months before and a few months after Stalin's death. But we like the title The Last Days of Stalin because it focuses attention on his collapse on March 1st, his death on March 5th, and it recalls a very famous book by U. Trevor Roper about Hitler, The Last Days of Hitler, and Hitler in the bunker in April of 1945. So it's an echo of that.
You know, it's funny because in my history class here in Slovenia, we learned a lot about Nazi Germany. We paid a lot of attention to that. Like, we learned it. But I think the Soviet Union was mentioned once, twice, maybe. We didn't learn that much about Stalin, you know? I'm not sure why, but it was all focused on fascism and gulags weren't even mentioned, which is interesting.
Well, that's a shame. Because obviously the Soviet experience had a lot of influence on all of Yugoslavia, even after Tito broke with Stalin.
Well, where can people find you?
I'm on the internet. People can go to my website, www.joshuarubenstein.com. They can contact me that way. My book, The Last Days of Stalin, and I'm going to show it to people. May I show it to people? This
Oh,
is
yeah.
the US edition, the English language edition, The Last Days of Stalin. It's now come out in 10 foreign languages, and most recently in Russia. It's just been published in Moscow by Alpina Nonfiction. This year alone, in 2023, it came out in the Czech Republic in Czech, and it came out in France in French. So it's out in 10 foreign languages. I'd love to see an edition in Yugoslavia, of course, in Serbo-Croatian or Slovenian, if someone was interested. But I'm glad you're familiar with the book, and I appreciate you reaching out to me. Thank you.
All righty, then. Thanks so much, man.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
But I do know this.